It drove me every time to go better and better, of course. But the difference between the DDR and me was too big all the time. She was taller than me and she was faster. But every time I had in my head, okay, now I want to go, I want to beat her every time again. And I have the competition with her, then I go for it. But it was impossible after that, impossible.
Welcome back to another episode of the Social Kick Podcast. I'm Brian Lundquist, joined by a crew here this morning, Luke Paddington, Dr. John Mullen, and an absolute legend in world swimming. We're so excited to get to know Anit Brigitta. Welcome in. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you very much.
Well, absolute legend. I was telling you before the show that I love the swimming history, the history of swimming. I am all of us are huge swimming nerds. I'm from the Caribbean. I'm from an island in the Caribbean. I've heard of your name, but I know very little about you. So I would like to spend the social kick just getting to know you and just talk about your life. I mean, it's
yeah.
Let's see where it's going. And so I'm fascinated. Let's go back to the very, very beginning. Curaçao is where you were born.
Yeah.
What was born like? Go ahead.
I was born on April 15, 1955.
Yeah.
In Curaçao. I am the oldest of five children. And my father came from Curaçao and my mother is a Dutch lady from Holland.
So what was life like? I have an image here. Is this your mother?
Yes, that's my mom and me.
Oh wow! So, what was life like for you then in Curaçao? How what was the population of Curaçao? What was life like in Curaçao in the '50s and in sixties?
Yeah, my parents, they know each other. They learn each other in Holland. My father was at the Navy at the end in the years 40, halfway 40s, 50s. And then he want to go back to Curaçao because he want to start a new life in Curaçao. But first of that, he was in Holland and he was by the Navy. So he go to Curaçao because he wanted to be a policeman. And my mother follow him after a few months with the boat to Curaçao. So
who are these people?
Oh, you know who she is? It's the mother from my grandmother, 79 years old.
Wow.
She get 97 years old.
Wow.
Yeah. The women in the family are very strong. My other grandmother was 95 here in Holland, also 95 years old. Yeah. So when I was a baby, I go to the beach from 2-3 months already. My mom take me on her arms and put me in the salt water. She put the water on me. And I think that was the beginning when I loved the sea, the swimming at the water. And yeah, in Curaçao, you know what, Luke? It's a Caribbean. It's hot there, warm. So always go to the beach. Every time when we have vacations or something like that, we go to the beaches. Mm-hmm. So I grow up with the beach and I love the water. I love the sea. And I think there the beginning starts for me. This was the swimming, starting with swimming. Mm. These What's are that? The neighbors from us. Yeah. I'm the second one on your right hand upstairs.
What were there pools that you guys had access to?
No.
Was there even a pool in Curaçao?
When I start with swimming, I start swimning in the beach. My mom learns me swimming, how to swim and how to survive in the sea. There was not a pool. Later, when I was about 9 years old, I start swimming by a swimming club. And that was a 50-meter pool, but salt water. They take the water from the sea, put the water in the pool. Mm-hmm. And then they throw it out, put fresh water again. So that's why I start swimming
for
competition.
Is that what this is?
Yes. Let me see. No, this is not the pool. That is an that is another pool. It's not that pool. It's a pool from the Shell. For people who are working by the Shell, they can swim over there.
So that's the oil company.
Yes, for the company, not for me.
So was that restricted then? Was it restricted? Like, was it tough to get into pools, especially the was it an elitist pool that it was hard to get membership to get into?
That pool, what you see, just was a membership, but not for us. The I was with my swimming club in the other pool where we train in the 50 meter in seawater, salt water. But later, when I was swimming faster and more, then I can swim in the other pool. That was a pool from 33 and a half meters. 33 and a half meters. That was, the water was sweet there.
What do you remember about that training? How frequently were you swimming and what were some of the practices like?
In the beginning, when I was 9 years old, I start swimming twice a week. And a year later, three times a week. And about when I was 11 years old, I still came up. I was one of the fastest girls already because I like to swim. I like to race. I like to be number one all the time. So I was in the beginning, 11 years, 12 years, I was the fastest woman from Curaçao already. I started training with the men's because, I wanted to beat the men's also. So it starts with me.
It's remarkable. Go ahead, Sarburn.
What was the sporting environment like? It sounds like you were very competitive from an early age. Did your parents support swimming as a sport? And did you treat it like I'm here to win more so than there to have fun?
In the beginning, it was for fun because, I told my parents I want to go to a swimming club and my brothers also want to go to the swimming club. And, after that, my parents saw me, she wants more than go for fun. So they brought me some more days in the week so I can train more and more. And I think that was the time, 11, 12 years, when I started swimming. But when I it's not so fast if you think it's the same as in Holland. It was more for fun. All the people in the club are swimming for fun and have fun with each other, not for racing. Mm-hmm. I want to race.
Was sport common though in those days, saying choosing swimming? Was swimming a popular sport to do, or were a lot of other kids doing other things that were more popular?
No, it was not popular. Also, and included the local people. A lot of local people couldn't swim there. The most of the people who could swim were people from Dutch families or other families, but the local people, the most of them, couldn't swim. So it was special to go to swimming because we can swim. My mother learned on swimming on the beach, but it was not normal for the local people because the most of them couldn't swim at the time.
Do you realize how remarkable that statement is, gentlemen? Curaçao is a very small island. The current population is only 150,000. Back then, it's probably 70,000, 80,000. Yeah. I mean, you are probably 3 minutes from water. The water was in your backyard. So the guy who taught me to swim, Joey Kaufman. Joey Kaufman introduced swimming to Trinidad in 1957. Swimming did not exist in Trinidad before then. And I think that's common for many Caribbean islands. The sport of swimming was just not in the island, correct?
No, that's right. We have a lot of sea and nice beaches, but a lot of people and the parents of the kids couldn't swim. So they don't go to the beach or somewhere else to them because they say, we cannot swim. When something happened there, we cannot help you. So they go away from the beaches.
Mm-hmm. So that's true. When you started getting better, were you able to, was Curaçao able to help support you on your journey up until 15? Like, were you able to go to swim meets? Did you ever go to the States? At the time, George Haynes was doing legendary work at Santa Clara. Were you ever able to do trips away?
My first trip was on Curaçao when I lived there. I was 13 years old. And I go with the coach, Toos Beumer. She was from the Olympic Mexico. And she was to Curacao to give training there for the clubs. And I go with her to the Pan American Games. And I was 13 years old. That was my first big event there. And I got there the third place. And it was 1,000th of difference with number four. So I get the fourth place, but we had the same time, but it was 1,000th of difference. So but that was 13, my first meet.
At age 13, you represented Curacao at the Pan Am Games and you came fourth by 1,000th of a second.
Yes. Whoa. Yeah. And after that, they'd say, we don't do any thousands anymore. It's the last time.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I go to Holland on my 15th. So then I go to Holland, to Amsterdam, and there I start training very fast. But in the Caribbean, it was okay. It was for fun and not really, what do you say, special? Special.
Special.
Yeah.
Tell us about that move to Holland. What led to the decision to move, and how did you know which?
My parents were divorced. They had a divorce. They are divorced. So my mother chose with the five kids to go to Holland.
Wow. Whoa.
And it was hard for her to stay on Curacao. So she make a choice. No, we go to Holland. So you, all of you have a better future in Holland than on the small island there.
Mm-hmm.
So I think after that, for me, was the best choice. Because I think when I don't go to Holland, I've never been a good swimmer like I did before. Never. So, yeah.
But what was that like, Enid? If you showed up in Holland and it's very different. You see snow for the first time. People are super tall. I mean, it's a culture shock.
As
a
everything is different. Because live in the Caribbean is, okay, you see you tomorrow. Don't worry. Be happy. Yeah. And in Holland, everything is straight, is correct. Be on time. Go there. And wash your hands and take your clothes off. After swimming, change another swimming suit. I never did it in the Caribbean. You swim, you keep the same swimming suit. There you swim all the meets. But in Holland, you have to do a lot of things. Everything is different. Hmm. So I have to get used to that. And my coach at the moment, Willy Storm, she told me what to do and how I have to do this and why I have to do it. So, okay, I think about it and I did all the things she told me. So that was very, it was difficult. But in the beginning was also difficult when we came to Holland because we don't have a house, nothing. My mother came there with five kids and we don't have a house, nothing. So we go to some friends, but they were still 70s people, and we stay there with seven people in a small house. So it was difficult for us.
Yeah, I mean, sounds like a really big transition on so many levels. How did you continue to swim and use swimming maybe to help you through that difficult time?
Yeah, I go very fast when I was in Holland. I go to the club because I wanted to go to do something. I go to want to go to the club. Mm-hmm. So I go to the club in Amsterdam and I start swimming there and they see me. They see how I was swimming. Okay, they were very happy and okay, I did very well. Wow. They was very surprised about me. Mm-hmm. But after that, a few months, we leave to another place in Holland because we couldn't stay by the family because it was too, busy with all the little kids and me. So we go to another place, Alkmaar. It's about an hour from Amsterdam.
Mm-hmm.
And so I told my coach, sorry, I have to go. I have to move because, we couldn't stay there. And she said, I want you to stay here in Amsterdam because, you have to train here with us. And okay. And so she was helping us, the family, to looking for a house somewhere. But it was very difficult because the winter came and we stay in a summer house, very cold there. And my mother was looking for work she have to work, look for work there. And in a few months, she found work in another place in Alkmaar. And so we get a house in Alkmaar. But the distance to go to Amsterdam was very heavy. And after school, I have to go to the train and stay an hour in the train and to make my homework and to go training. And after the training, 1 hour back again. So it was too late for me. Everything was difficult to stay and to keep training like that. So now a few weeks, I move in by a friend of mine in Amsterdam. Mm-hmm. And I stay there at her house and we go to school together. And so the training and everything was easier for me to do.
It sounds like your mother was able to see your how good you were at swimming and support that. That's a big thing.
Yes.
To
yes.
Let her child go away.
Yeah. And the coach, she was looking with the swimming association from Holland to find a house in Amsterdam so the whole family can come back to Amsterdam so we can live together. And they found, after a year, a house for us. And so the family was complete and, yeah, we stayed together. But it was after a year. And I go in the weekends, I go home to see my mother and the families, of course.
I was just saying that I remember the transition for me when I left Trinidad to go to Canada. And I sat in a classroom for the first time and I looked around me and I had never been in a classroom full of people the same color skin as me, full of white people everywhere. I remember literally saying, wow, a room of 100 people who are all white. How many swimmers were black in your club, in your conference meets, in the country of Holland swimming? And how that how
in my club were three people were black. I was one and two other peoples. The other peoples, the parents, the father was from Suriname.
Mm-hmm.
So that were we three of us were the only people. The other was all the people were white. Yeah.
Did you encounter any prejudice?
Do I what?
Did you encounter any prejudice during that time?
No.
Yeah.
For me, you know, in Holland, yeah, for me, it was not, yeah, the people were very nice, very special. Everybody in Holland, I think it was the best club I couldn't get in Holland there. Very social. Everybody.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So you're 15, 16 years old, and the Munich Olympic Games are coming up. And you obviously qualify, but you make a big decision to swim for Holland and not Curaçao. Would you explain this decision?
Yeah, it was very difficult to swim for Curaçao. When I swam for Curaçao, I couldn't swim for Holland. And the point was also that in Holland, when you are in the Dutch team, you go everywhere. You have a lot of international meets in Europe, all over the world. In Curaçao, when I swim for Curaçao, I have to pay everything by myself. And when I go to the meets, I have to go alone. I have to pay for the flights. I have to pay for the hotels. I have to pay for the meets, everything. Mm-hmm. And Curaçao is a poor island, so they couldn't pay that for me. So that's why I make a choice. So it's better for me to swim for the Dutch team so they can pay everything. And I have more experience with the meets and competitions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in Holland, they pay everything. So I don't have to go to fly to Curaçao to go for a meet somewhere else. But it's too expensive. And I didn't have the money also to fly and to go everywhere.
If Curaçao were funded and did have the money and the facilities, would it be a question if you swam for them or not, if they had the funding to support you?
Yeah, that was what I was thinking. It's difficult because I cannot go with the team everywhere. I have to go alone everywhere. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
So I make a choice to stay and to swim for Holland because then, then I'm one of the team members. And in Curaçao, I'm the only one. I make a choice to swim for Holland. That's why.
No, I feel you. I have represented Trinidad and being the only person at the meet. And you don't have a masseuse and a physio and a doctor and a nutritionist. You
Nothing.
Might have, I might bring my friend who's my coach or something. That's it. You have no supports.
No, that's true. Also, and in Holland, you have the doctors, you have the masseurs, everything what you have, what you need, you can get it. Mm-hmm. And when you're not one of the team from Holland, from the Dutch team, you stay outside and you have nothing there. That's the trouble.
Yeah, I hear you. So you went to the Munich Olympic Games, a monumental games in swimming. You were 17 years old. Talk about that games. How many finals you made? What were the events in? What was that experience like, your first Olympic game?
I make six times and I make the finals. And for me, it was one of the biggest things what I was going for the Olympics. It was one of my biggest meets. So it was a very big, nice experience to see and to enjoy. But after that, I say I go for another one, because now I know what it is to go to the Olympics. But it was very hard. I swim six times the finals there. I swim all my times were the best times I swim. I was one of the best swimmer at that moment from the Dutch team. No one of the swimmers get to the finals. And I was the only swimmer who make all the starts. I go to the finals. It was hard, but I learned a lot, because you have to swim when you go swimming in the morning. You have to swim on your best times to make the finals. Right. When you don't make your best times, you're out of it. So I remember that, and I was concentrated to go for my best with everything. And for a 100-meter freestyle, you have to swim three times. The series, the B final, nog een final. Mm-hmm. And that was very hard. And every time I have to make and to go for the best times again. Mm-hmm. So, I like to do that. And it was a very good experience. And I thought I want to go to another Olympics. And that was in 1976. So now I know how it is to go there, because we are small island in Holland also. And when you come up from the beginning to the starts, you have to walk in the stadium, swimming stadium. So I don't get used to that. So it was what's happened here? But you have to stay concentrate for the meet. But I did very well, I think, for that moment. Yeah.
I looked at some of your meets. So I saw that you finaled the 100 free. You went 006. You led off the 4x1 relay with going 59. So you broke a minute leading up the 4x1.
Yeah.
200 backstroke, 200 freestyle. What other events did you swim in? And I mean, guys, have you heard these events? It's a heck of a schedule for a 17-year-old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a heavy, because I swim backstroke and freestyle, and I can swim fly also, but I have to make a choice. What are you swimming? Because the backstroke and freestyle are on the same day, and the time between back and freestyle is very small. Between a half an hour, you have to go again. So I make the most of the times I make the choice to do for the freestyle. Because, you want to do one thing good and a relay, I always swim also in the relays.
Was that common in those days to swim such a heavy event schedule, or were there athletes that were specializing in one or two events?
I think there are people who can do that. And Mark Spitz can do everything, you remember? So he can swim everything. But for me, I have to make a choice. And I don't get used to swim more than one, two heats, after each other. So I make a choice to do one of these.
I'm curious to know. So we do want to get into Montreal and the rest of the career, but I'm curious at this point in your career, especially after the Munich Games, do you remember much about what your training schedule was like, and also what you learned from Munich in terms of how your races turned out, your race strategies that you were, what sorts of improvements you were looking to make?
Yes, of course. Normally I make the schedules in Holland after Munich We see it every year. We are training for over 4 years. We train for the next year, because the next year we have a European champion of some of a world champion. So we train for that time, for this thing. Mm-hmm. But in Holland, it's difficult sometimes, because in May, we just go train outside. So the swimming pools are closed inside. The summer is coming, so you have to go outside to train in a 50-meter pool. Uh-huh. But sometimes the weather is very bad here. It's 15, 16, 17 degrees, and you have to go outside. Oh. Sometimes you cannot make your training program. You cannot follow it because it's too cold. Sometimes my arms were freezing, and I'm from the Caribbean, so I don't get used so much to the cold water there. I hate it. And still now I don't like it.
Me too. But,
You know, the programs were so that I have to make more kilometers. And I remember I go to Mission Viejo with another girl from the Dutch swimmers, and to train by Mark Schubert to do some experience and to train better, because the weather is much better than in Holland. So that was for me for the Olympic Games in 1976. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we do some more technical things. I do what more, what zeg je dat, Jan? Met gewichten, weights. I train with weights. Uh-huh. Yeah. So yeah, a little more of the things.
Hmm. In those 4 years, I want to talk about the cultural aspect of what you experience as well. So correct me, am I wrong? You are the first black swimmer to make an Olympic final in 1972. I don't know of any other who may have made an Olympic final. But in those finals, you started seeing 13-year-old girls, Cornelia Ender, for instance, first made an appearance at 13 years old in those games. And then, you know, the rise, the East Germans were always there in swimming, as were the West Germans, as were the Hungarians. But what was the landscape of swimming like in those 4 years? How did it start to change? You always had the Americans, Shirley Babashoff, these people, but you started to see a difference in those 4 years, an evolution of the landscape, you know?
Yes, yes. After the world champions in 1973, that was the first Olympic.
Ever.
In Belgrado. Then the East German girls came to them. They came up, whoop, and very fast. So everything changed that from that moment, everything changed, because all the DDR girls came there. Mm-hmm. But it was so strange for me, and for everybody, because they don't speak with nobody. They don't speak to say nothing. They don't have a talk with you. They don't do nothing. So yeah, it was a very big change what I have as experience at that moment. But for me also was very difficult, because all the time the interviewers told me, why don't you get number one in it? Why don't you go faster than them? And it was for me difficult, because I was training very hard, very fast, but I never can beat them. Because after everything, you know why we can beat them.
Yeah. Did you know at the time? Did you know something was strange happening at the time?
Yes, yes. I always thought there was something strange, but you don't know what. Because after all the meets, we have to go to the doping control. And the doping control was okay. The German girls, okay. Nobody had nothing. All the tests, what they did, was okay. So, but in my mind, I think, in my head, I always think there must be something. Why they always won everything? It was, but I couldn't know. I didn't know what's wrong.
Yeah, like you said, that's a very interesting perspective. And like you said, it starts to maybe play mental games with you. Start looking at probably all your competitors. So yes. Was it the East Germans that you're like, man, since they came up so quick,
yes,
what are they doing? Or was it other countries and other places as well?
They were very tall. And when they were behind me somewhere and they were speaking, you just think, oh, there's a man behind me. They were talking like men's. Remember this mm-hmm. yeah, I think, oh, because the choice was just like men's, they were talking. So that was the thing I was thinking, it's strange. Why did they speak like that, like a man?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. That's an important consideration, because at the time there was a massive domination in swimming by the USA men. Mark Spitz winning everything. And in 1976, the USA men set records in almost every event. However, it was not a sudden rise as astronomical, and it weren't physical attributes changing that led to suspicion. That was the difference, don't you believe?
So, yes.
Yes.
I think so. But Cornelia Ender, she speak normal. Mm. Cornelia Ender was, you don't hear nothing from her. She speak like a woman. But most of the other swimmers, and the different thing was there were more good swimmers. And in 1 year, you never see them back. You don't know what's happened with them. They were very good at that moment, and a few months later, you never still saw them back.
Wow. So there was
that was very strange also.
Yeah. So there was just continuously this,
they were continue checking, and yeah, I think something with the hormones, when it's not okay, they don't go to the meet. So they take them away from the meets. That was always busy.
What did that do to you? So you go to 1976, you've had 3 years of this, you get on deck, and did that make you fierce and just want to take them down even more? What did that do to your racing and drive you?
You mean after that?
Like in 1976.
Yeah.
Did you just get fed up? And you're like, oh, come on. And it drove you to perform better than you may have?
It drove me every time to go better and better, of course. But the difference between the DDR and me was too big all the time. And she was taller than me, and she was faster. But every time I had in my head, okay, now I want to go. I want to beat her every time again. And I have the competition with her. Then I go for it. But it was impossible after that. Impossible.
You go to the 1976 Olympics and you make a number of finals and you get two bronze medals. You drop 3 seconds in your 100 freestyle and go 56, yet still end up coming third, even because two people ahead of you break the world record. You have a remarkable Olympics. You swim your best times by far.
Yes, for me it was my best what I could do at that moment. I couldn't go faster. It was, and I remember I was with Shirley Babashoff. She was also there, and she was once, she was twice, and I was third. But it was, we have to fight, but it was, very difficult for us to win.
There's a very famous story of the Americans winning that 4x100 freestyle relay in overcoming. Describe your perspective of this moment.
Yeah, we were there also with our relay team, but it was very, very exciting because nobody from the DDR thought that somebody else could win there. Mm-hmm. But it was very nice to see that the four girls from the States won that game. Everybody was for, oh, they beat him. Wow, fantastic. Yeah, we were, I think, fourth or fifth over there. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
So eventually, all the news would come out after the investigation or report in, was it 1990, that would substantiate everything that you all knew at the time, that these tournaments were doping and there was systematic doping going on. But also those reports indicated that that this was done without the knowledge of the swimmers and, without them actually knowing. Do you believe that to be true? And if so, do you have any sympathy for those swimmers, especially as you talk about them having come in, been successful for 1 year, and then they're discarded? Yeah. What are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, it was very strange for me. But I, when we heard about in the years 1990 about the things from the, it was a shock for me, because we always thought there was something, but we didn't know what's wrong with him. So it was a very shock for me to hear that the DDR used anabolas and everything at that moment. It was a shock. But later, a few years ago, I met Cornelia Ender. We met each other. I don't know if you know that. I go to Cornelia Ender and we meet each other and we spoke with each other. The thing was that, yes, I was there with her. She told me different things that she didn't can speak and with nobody. That was, what is verboden, Jan? That was not permitted to speak with other swimmers. Mm-hmm. She was in training from, I think, 8-9 years old. Because she wanted to go for the swimmer. She was the best swimmer there. So she wanted to be a swimmer. From 8-9 years old, she go to a special school. She didn't know what happened.
Take away from her family, right? They took her away
from her family away to an internet to go to train there. She thought that, to be a good swimmer, they take some blood and they told her you get some vitamins to take and you can do this. But she didn't know. Nobody knows what was wrong there. That's so she told me. So, yeah. So I have another look about her and the other team, because it's not nice when they do all a lot of things with your body and you don't know what's happened.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Why are they still considered Olympic champions? Why aren't you Olympic? Why are they still in the record books, the Olympic champions?
Yeah, they wanted to be the best of the world, eh?
No, but still to this day, those swimmers who beat you, they're still considered the Olympic champion. Why hasn't it changed for you to be the gold medalist?
Yes, the International Committee from the Olympics, that bedoelt Jan Jan, they don't want to change it. And yeah, I feel so sorry because the International Olympic Committee, they say, no, it's a long time ago. We cannot do nothing anymore about it. But yeah, I don't think it's nice because everybody wants to have a gold medal. And when you have a gold medal, then you are the best of the world. But I feel so sorry and angry about this because I know a lot of sporters from the whole world. Everybody was fighting to get the medals they have to get. But the International Olympic Committee, they don't want to do it anymore. And it's so sorry. Yeah, I feel pain in my heart also.
No, definitely. I think this is something that they need to reconsider.
It's a long time ago, so I go farther with my life. I don't stay from, I'm sorry. No, I have to go farther with my life. I cannot be
Mm-hmm. Certainly. And obviously, like you said, you're moving on from it. But what do you think they could do to rectify this? Is it giving medals? Is it just changing the names and the results? What do you think would...
Yes, I think they have to do that. Yeah, I think that was fair to do that and to give everybody the medals they swim and they have, recht op, what is it? What they earn. I think they have to do that. And I think with me, all the sporters thinking like this. Yeah, that is fair.
Do you consider yourself an Olympic champion?
Maybe. Yeah. Yeah. And the world champions also, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Also the same.
So there's a stat I saw that of the 11 major medals that you've won, Europeans, Worlds, and Olympics, it was proven that you were beaten in 10 times, not 11, because one time was Shirley Babashoff. 10 times it was proven that they were proven drug cheats. That's what I've read this. That's remarkable. You were.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Like proven, like the two doctors in 1990 found the files, found the names, said this athlete was in this program, and this athlete went on to beat Enith at the World Championship. Like it was there, it's all in records. It's not just essay. So you are a five-time world record holder. You set world records in show course world championships as a black swimmer in 1974, maybe. I don't know for sure. But that's incredible.
from 1973. After Munich, and then the world champions, European champions, world champions again. Yeah.
You hold 100 Dutch records. You are the top swimmer in Holland. So gentlemen, Holland in the 1970s, there was one sport. It was soccer. It was Johan Cruyff. It was two World Cup finals. And you were a legitimate star with Cruyff. I mean, you were out there, the one of the top athletes in a country that was soccer crazy. Describe what it was like. How were you welcomed? If you were not championed by the IOC still, but how were you welcomed back home? What was that like for you?
Yeah, I was with Johan Cruyff. We were the best sporters of the year twice. And Johan Cruyff by the men and I with the women. So we met each other, and Holland gave me a lot of surprise prizes. Onderscheidingen, what is it, Jan? Holland gave me a lot of, say that?
Honors.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and the biggest honors I got from the Queen here, also a paper and things. But yes, it's difficult because, in Holland you don't get rich from swimming.
No.
And soccer or basketball or something else, you are a rich man.
There's not too many places you get rich from swimming.
At this moment, the girls and boys, they get some more money.
They do,
In my time, you don't get nothing. You get the radio. You get the radio to go.
I'm curious.
Chair. You get the chair for your house.
T-shirts. Yes.
One T-shirt.
One T-shirt. Yeah. Oh, well, I'm curious about that because that's, we're in the year 2021, we look back upon this era of swimming. And one of the things that stands out the most is the age. I mean, we've talked about some of the ages here. And of course, systematic doping will help a 13-year-old get on the Olympic podium. But even non-dopers were the best among the sport were oftentimes teenagers, maybe even people in their early 20s. And there wasn't a career beyond that age. Whereas today there is professionalism in sport, and even if they're not making much money, we see athletes swimming into their 30s.
Yes.
What were your thoughts at the end of your career? Did you feel like you had more left, or had you already decided this is the age and therefore I stopped swimming?
No, I swim, I think 10 years and a few years in Curaçao. For me it was okay because I was the oldest swimmer. At the time, I was 21, 22, and all the swimmers were 13 years, 14 years. So you don't have a connection anymore with the younger swimmers. Right. So I thought I go to the last world champion, and then it's okay. For me, it's enough. Because when you are the oldest swimmer of the team, that's not fine also.
No.
So that's why I quit at the moment. But I go for home for softball. I play softball after that for fun with the team. I go for tennis to do something else. And I still keep training for more than 10, 20 years to train up, to build that down. So I don't stop immediately. I keep training because I have to build that down. That's what the doctor told me. Don't stop. Keep training. But... you have to keep training your whole life.
That's good for this too. So
yes.
And then you went to Curaçao and you opened a swimming school. Describe this. Why did you go home? Why did you open that school? Why was that important to you?
Yeah, my husband, he find a job on Curaçao. That's why we're going. My husband is teacher in the school. So there was they were looking for a teacher. So he write a card and everything. So that's why that was the reason why we go to Curaçao back. Mm-hmm. Because when you don't have work there, you cannot stay in life. You cannot live there. So you have to go for a job there. Otherwise, it's impossible to go to an island there when you don't have a job. So we have a job there. He find one. And then we go for 3 or 6 years. Mm-hmm. But we stay there for 20 years. The kids growing up there, go to school. I have another baby there, so the number 3 is coming there. And yeah, after all the times I started swimming with a swimming school, because I find out there that the people who are there, there's no lot things to do for the kids. I was the first lady there who give baby swimming and for little children. Nobody did it there. So I started the swimming club for babies, for children from 1, 2, 3, 4 years. And for adults, I give aqua jogging, aqua fitness. Nobody did it there. So for me, was the world was open to start with a lot of new different things there on the island. So I did that for 20 years till we go back to Holland at the moment.
How many people learn to swim in your swimming school? Like you have you, I mean, I swam in an era when Curaçao was known for water polo and swimming. I played water polo against your country many, many times, and they were yes. amazing. They were very organized.
Yes.
Team is the club is Sitok. It's a great club. So obviously things change a lot. I mean, you must have had a big part to do with that.
Yes, the clubs are very good. There are a lot of swimming clubs at the moment, eh? At that time also. But there was nobody there who learned kids swimming. Mm. And the way they did it over there was very old. They do it on the way, so for 40, 50 years ago. So I came there with new inspiration. So how I learned swimming, how I learned the kids, teach them to learn swimming. So for me, it was something new. No, for there, it was something new to find out how I was giving the lessons. But I had a lot of people there, who, I think more than 1,000 people and children who learned swimming with me. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Your name is on a pool now. They've named the Piscina Edith Bridget there. Your a beautiful mural of you is at the pool. In fact, there's a picture of the Dutch Olympic team training there right now in front of it. And Kira Toussaint and these people are in front of your mural. So they've absolutely honored you and they value you in your contribution. What your name is not on their record books because even though your times are faster, because you were not swimming for Curaçao, I'm assuming. But why is it that I have not heard about you as the first Caribbean medalist? Is it because, I mean, do you identify yourself as a Caribbean person?
I'm from the Caribbean. I feel like a Caribbean girl. But yes, my future, my top sport career was in Holland. Yeah. And I think when I not go to Holland, I never been a swimmer like this.
No way.
I've never been a top swimmer like that. In Curaçao, I don't make that. So it's, yeah, I feel I'm from the Caribbean still. But it's, yeah, I know when I stay there, I have never been to the top. Never.
Most of our athletes who have excelled were not able to stay in the Caribbean past the age of 15. No. Anthony Nesty, George Bovell, Ali Atkinson, Janelle Atkinson, Aria Vanderbilt Wallace. They all have
the most. Yeah, you know why? Because I think there are better coaches everywhere. Curaçao is a small island. They don't have so good and so many good coaches. That's why a lot of people go away to other coaches in the world. That's why.
I believe this can change. And I do know that Trinidad has a fantastic facility now. And they are very good knowledge now in the Caribbean. So I do know this is just can change and this will change. So I do encourage those listening that it is very possible to stay at home, just like Usain Bolt trained at home in Jamaica with Glenn Mills and became a superstar. I do believe it's happening now in the Caribbean. So I'm saying there is a future here. So I'm glad. Don't you agree? So
I think it's okay, but I don't think at swimming. I don't hear no of the swimmers.
It's a money too.
Yeah, it's money too. And you know what's the point over there? I was coaching also there for the swimming team. The problem is that all the families, when they go outside, they have to pay everything. They have to pay the flight. They have to pay the hotels. They have to pay this. And it's not for everybody acceptable. So not everybody have enough money to pay that for the children. That's the problem. So then they quit. That's why.
Yep.
And the parents, they have to pay a lot of things and it's expensive. And living on an island is expensive.
It's
you have to fly everywhere.
And that really does not help the underserved communities in the Caribbean. You often see people of my skin complexion swim well because often their families have the money to support them, to pay for them to go to World Championships. Also, the pressure of a 13-year-old. I was just telling my friend, 13 years old, I got a call. Luke, you've made your first national team. Can you go to, I forget where it was. And I was like, I cannot make this decision because I know my parents have to pay for this. And I cannot make this decision as a 13-year-old. And parents have that pressure as well. So things have to change. And that's the big thing.
Yes, things have to change. That's true. Yeah. And swimming is in Curaçao for people who can pay. That's the point.
Let's talk about where swimming is going now, especially. This is Black History Month in the United States. And we are seeing, we had our first, technically our first female Olympic gold medalist in 100-meter freestyle with amazing Simon Manuel. Anthony Nesty, what he did in 1988 is legendary. Leanne Martindale, the list goes on. Aaliyah Atkinson, list goes on. Talk to me about when you see this, when you see the rise of people of color in the sport.
And yeah, it's a big change.
Talk about this.
Yeah, it's a big change. Of course, I can see it. I follow it. I see it. But in the time I started with swimming, the black people thought, oh, we cannot swim. The only thing what we can do is to run fast. We are not built for swimmers. And after a long time, okay, there came a knop up. And they believe in swimming. But in the years 70s, when I was swimming, nobody thought, okay, we can be a good swimmer, because they think, no, it's impossible. But I don't believe that. I think it's possible for everybody. When you have, when you are a good swimmer, a good sporter, you can do it.
So what gave you that confidence? Did you have role models, maybe your parents or other athletes that you looked up to, or what gave
you? I think I was a role model for Curaçao. And I think maybe for Suriname also, because Anthony Nesty was after me, the one of the biggest swimmers from ever, Olympic medal. So, but after that, I go to the Olympics, I saw on Curaçao that a lot of clubs are a lot of people and kids coming to the clubs to swim there. But in the beginning, it was very low. But after me, a lot of swimmers go more and more to the pools.
Definitely. I think
it helps. And I think in the state also,
Oh, yeah.
In the states also. Yeah.
No. We are seeing the rise of young people of color in the NCAA system now. We have never seen that as much before, have we, Brian or John? I mean, we're seeing a rise now, but it's still less than 1%. There was a stat I saw of the 73,000 registered swimmers in the United Kingdom. Wow. 668 are registered as non-white. That's less than 0.5%. So we still have a very long way to go. But, you know, do you work in the community now? Are you still involved? Do you speak to the Dutch team? Do you work with Renomi and Kirit Kassant?
I speak with them. Yeah, I speak with them. And sometimes I go to when they have a meet in Holland, then I go to look and I speak with them. I know they have a training camp in Curaçao now at the moment. Mm-hmm. So, I have contact with the coaches. I'm not coaching because, it takes me a lot of time to coach and to go everywhere. So I'm not coaching, but I speak to them oftenly. Yeah. And I'm still working in the pool. I still give swimming lessons at the moment.
Wow.
So, yeah, I work till August and then I go quit. Then the time is over.
Yeah. It's cool.
Yeah, retirement.
I saw there's an aquatic center in Peter van den Hoogenband's name. Is there an aquatic center in your name?
No, not yet. No. No.
Because they need to change those record books. They need to give you the recognition, and it needs to be done also in English. It hasn't been out there. I'm telling you, we are swimming nerds. I'm from the Caribbean. I did not know this about you until I heard. In fact, some of the most well-versed swimmers and coaches in the Caribbean have a misconception of where you're from or what you're about, because it's just not out there.
But it's a long time ago for me. Mm-hmm. And you still remember me, you still know me, but it's a long time ago.
It's
45 years ago, eh? And you still know me.
All the more, yes, that's true. That's true. what advice do you have for that person from a small country in Africa who has this potential? You know, let's not think about the Caribbean. Let's think about other India. Nobody in India can swim. Is that
perception?
That's what they say. It's a cultural thing. You know, what advice do you have for people who have to fight these biases that are hearing from their own mother? Go and study medicine. Don't do this. You know, how did you persevere?
Yes, it's difficult. I think where you grow up in the world, the parts of the world is changing a lot. But a lot of countries, such as India and other countries, they don't change so much.
No.
I think it's difficult to change the systems in the countries there. So everybody can sport, everybody can do this.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult to break in there.
Difficult.
Yeah, it's very difficult. And the thing is, on the little islands in the Caribbean, is that a lot of people and boys and girls after the high school, they go study somewhere else. So they move from the islands, they go to Holland, to America, to other countries. That's very difficult. That's why we lost all the swimmers there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I don't know how it is in Trinidad, but in Curaçao, a lot of them are going.
When I finished university, I'm sorry, when I finished high school, I went to university to study. I was 17. I was like, now I'm going to study. I finished. And I happened to find a pool. I happened to find a coach. And my career continued until the old age of 24. But I remember being on a national team at the Caribbean Island Swimming Championships and feeling so old and not connected because I was 24 and they were 15-year-olds and 14-year-olds.
Yeah, yeah. And then you don't have connect with nobody. It's difficult.
It was very hard. However, maybe if I had swum with a team and I met John and Brian of my age and right? So it was hard to connect. But
yeah, I know. I understand that. And that's why I quit also when I was 21 years old, 21.
Yeah.
And all the younger swimmers are coming and all the other ones are quit with swimming. And I stay there alone. For me, it was not fun anymore to go.
I asked Gustavo Borges a couple of days ago, what was his greatest achievement in swimming? Because he said, obviously, his children are his greatest achievement in life. But in swimming, what was the race that he will never forget? What about you? What was that moment? Was it your world record, your medal, your first Olympics? What do you think was the one that brings you the most pride to you?
For me, was in the beginning, Munich was for me the first big meet. For me, was very important that I can make the finals.
Mm-hmm.
That I can get in the finals because, that was very hard, very difficult to make the finals. That was in the beginning. So I was happy to go in the finals. But after that, you want more and more and more.
Yes.
And years after that, I go to the world champions. Okay, I want to go by the first three. So for me, was the world champions in 1973 was a surprise because I get there the second place. And I didn't, it was completely a surprise, that moment. And after that, I believe in myself. And I wanted to be by the first three people.
Mm-hmm.
And Olympics are one of the famous things in the world also. Get a medal on the Olympics. Yeah, who wants that not?
How did you manage to keep touching the wall, be disappointed, by getting beat by somebody who you were, what's going on? And you got up, went next morning, trained, did a next meet and kept going. What kept you going when you kept getting knocked down? What kept you going?
How do you mean?
What kept you, every time you touched a wall,
yeah,
you got a third place to somebody you suspected that was just not right.
Yeah.
Hurt you. How did you get up to go again and fight that fight again and do better?
Yeah, you won, yeah. Every time you want to go better and you are thinking what's go wrong in that in the race, what was not good in the race for me. Dus every time I was thinking, okay, that was not okay, that was good, I have to do this, I have to go start earlier with this or later. Yeah, you learn from all the races you are swimming. Every time you learn things again, new. I was learning, yeah, to start faster with sprint or to, yeah, to keep it. Yeah, a lot of things. You learn from all the meets you're learning. You're learning better and better and better and better.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
That's beautiful. That's one thing that'll never change for sure. Anith, we just have a couple of quick questions to finish up with, some fun stuff. What's the hardest race in swimming?
The hardest race? The difficult race is 20 uh-huh. is 200 fly. That is the hardest thing for me.
Would you rather have an Olympic gold medal or a world record?
Yeah, Olympic medal. Olympic. But 100 meters swimming is also difficult. Hey, Luke?
Yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
John? 100 meters swimming is also very difficult to go. It's not easy.
No, it's not.
I know. I was pretty good at 90 easy. Meters.
No. And in my time, there was not 50 meters. But we swam 50 meters also. But it was not international.
Right.
But 50 meters is also difficult to swim. Everything has to go good and fast.
Uh-huh. That's so yes. true. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if that was a Gary thing. Pound for pound, the hardest race in swimming, 50 free. I'm just waiting for somebody else to say that besides him. Hey, so maybe to steal your thunder on that, what's one event or innovation in swimming that did not exist in your time that today is amazing and you think, wow, that would be so great to swim while we had that? Is there anything about swimming today?
Yeah, it's different. At the moment, when you go, your coach can go with you. In my time, the coach have to stay home and you go with the team, with another coach. Wow. But these are things what are changed in the last 10 years is everybody can go with the coach to the meet. Huh?
Yeah.
Yes. Wow. And in my time, it was not possible. You go with the team and yeah, you have to accept another coach. Uh-huh. And this is at the moment is the change.
So when you were 15 years old, you went to a meet with no coach and you had to figure it out on yourself. That's incredible.
Now, I was very lucky because my coach was an international coach also.
Okay.
So she go everywhere where I was. She was in the team from Holland.
Okay.
So I was very lucky in the time. But yeah, it's not normal. It's not...
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about somebody then who you probably inspired with Renomi, who's of both Japanese and Surinamese descent, but one of the best Dutch swimmers of all time. Assuming that you and Renomi had the same training techniques, the same pools, the same equipment, who wins straight up in 100 freestyle? You or Renomi?
I go.
56 yeah. in 1976.
And you know what also different was? I had very fast times on 25 meters. Oh. I had world records.
Right.
But in that time, they wasn't...
What was your times? I couldn't find your times. What was your world record in 100 meter freestyle short course meters?
55.23. Wow. And 175. 157.
157 for 200.
On 200 meters.
Wow. In 1973. Yeah. Incredible.
Yeah, but it was not official, eh? Officials.
Yeah.
At that time.
But so that
25 meters, they don't count at the moment, eh? When I was swimming.
Wow. So you set the world, they were world best, but not world records.
Because not world records, world best. Yeah, because in the most, at that time when I was swimming, there were not world records.
That's why Leo Atkinson is the first black world record holder, first Caribbean world record holder of woman. That's why, you know, that's why all these things happen now, because back then we didn't have the disqualification of the drug cheats. We didn't have the ability, we didn't have the official short course world records. We didn't have these things. Understood. Okay.
Yeah.
God, those times are so fast when you consider a 2 foot forward start. No dolphin kicks.
Goggles?
No goggles. In the Caribbean, I swim with nothing. No goggles, nothing. Jeez. And then when I go swim in Amsterdam, when I go to with my family to Amsterdam, I couldn't swim without the goggles. My eyes were crying the whole day from the water. And in Curaçao, I never swim with goggles. Never.
Whoa.
Jeez. It's a big difference.
Yeah. What a huge difference. Wow. Well, we want to be respectful of your time. And thank you so much for spending this time with us. It's such a pleasure to get to know you and to hear some of the history. And it's an important story for all of us in swimming to know today. So yeah, we really appreciate it. It's been a real honor.
Okay. Thank you very much. You too for listen to my story a little bit.
Thanks so much. That's it for this episode of the Social Kick Podcast, and we'll see you next time. Hey, everybody. Thanks for hanging out with us. If you're enjoying Social Kick, tell your friends about it. And be sure to tell us what you liked by leaving a comment and subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Instagram at the Social Kick Podcast. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel, The Social Kick. And you can find all of our content on our website at thesocialkick.com.